by Picot's law, which shows the relationship between current, discharge time and the capacity. Again, he did for a lead acid battery. So the relationship between current, discharge time and capacity of a lead acid battery, it is given over certain range of current values. It is given by T equal to QP upon IK, where QP is the capacity of the battery when discharged at a rate of 1 amperes. I is the current drawn from the battery. T is the amount of time, again it is in hours, that a battery can sustain. K, it is a constant. We normally, it is taken as around about 1.2 to 1.3. Okay, next topic is life of batteries. What is the life of battery? It is a general, it is a very common question. So for primary batteries or disposable batteries, typically they lose almost 8 to 20% of their original charge every year at room temperature of 20 degree to 30 degree Celsius. So every year they lose almost about 8 to 10, 20% of their original charge. Once you buy, it will automatically start to, it will automatically lose 8 to 20% of their original charge every year. This is known as a self-discharge rate, and it is due to non-current producing, that is side chemical reactions which occur within the cell, even if there is no load. Rate of the side reactions is reduced. You can reduce the rate at which it is side reactions are going on. You can reduce this if the batteries are stored at a lower temperature. Although some batteries can be damaged by freezing. So we have to see all the norms and we have to check the manufacturer's list we can get from the battery, the batteries manufacturing that material that is used. We can get all those details from the manufacturers of the battery. High or low working temperatures may reduce battery performance also. What they does is, what they do actually, they affect the initial voltage of the battery. For example, if an alkaline battery is there, this initial voltage will be approximately normally distributed around 1.6 volts. So what about life of secondary batteries? Storage life of secondary battery, that is limited by the chemical reactions that occur between the battery parts, electrodes, electrolytes, and these are called the side reactions. Again, internal parts may corrode or fail, or the active materials may be slowly converted to inactive forms. Since the active material on the battery plates changes chemical composition on each charge and discharge cycle, active material may be lost due to physical changes of volume. Again, this may limit the cycle life of the battery also. Again, there are old chemistry rechargeable batteries like lead acid batteries, I told, self-discharge more rapidly than disposable alkaline batteries, especially nickel-based batteries. A freshly charged, if you buy a fresh, freshly charged nickel-cadmium battery, it loses almost 10% of its charge in the first 24 hours. And again, then it thereafter it discharges at a rate of almost 10% a month. However, there are newer low self-discharge nickel metal hydride, that is NIMH, it is noted by NIMH batteries, and modern lithium designs have reduced the self-discharge rate to relatively low level. But again, they are still poorer than the primary batteries. So primary batteries do have some advantages compared to secondary batteries. Most nickel based batteries are partially discharged. So when you buy, they are almost partially discharged, and they must be charged before first use. New nickel metal hydride batteries are ready to be used when purchased and have only 15% discharge in a year. So that is an advantage of nickel metal hydride batteries. So how to extend battery life? What should we do to extend a battery life? Battery life can be extended if you store the batteries at a lower temperature. You can store them in a refrigerator or a freezer, which slows out the chemical reactions in the battery. Such storage can even extend the life of alkaline batteries by almost 5%. Research is have already been done, and they have come with the result that if we keep these batteries in a refrigerator or a freezer, they can extend the life of these alkaline batteries by about 5%. Rechargeable batteries can hold their charge much longer depending upon the type. What are the material, what are the electrodes that you are using, right? Now, if you want to reach the maximum voltage, again batteries must be returned to room temperature. Discharging an alkaline battery at 250 milliamperes at 0 degree Celsius is only half as efficient as it is at 20 degree Celsius. Again, manufacturers like Duracell, if you have bought an alkaline battery from the manufacturers Duracell, they do not recommend refrigerating batteries, because they do have some side effects. They do have hazardous conditions. They do not operate properly under those conditions, under cold conditions. So it will be better if you don't use alkaline battery under you don't keep alkaline battery under refrigerators or cold conditions. So many of us have desire, like when we are in kid, right? When we are in the 8th standard, 9th standard, we do think how to make homemade cells or batteries, right? Even if we go to the market, we do have some potato clocks, all those kinds of toys are also there, right? So we do have some desire to make homemade cells or batteries. So how to make homemade cells or batteries? Well, okay, so how to make? Almost any liquid or moist object that has enough ions to be electrically conductive can serve as an electrolyte. As a novelty or science demonstration, it is possible to insert two electrodes. We can have two electrodes made of different metals, right? We can dip it or we can fix it. We can insert those electrodes into lemon, potato, etc. and generate small amounts of electricity. See, this is like fun to make, but they can't be used in the real situation. The real situation means in the industries, commercial applications, they can't be used. This is just for making toys. You can have, what is there in lemon potato? If you see in lemon, there is a juicy substance is there, that is a citric acid, right? And in potato, we have phosphoric acid. We can have different salt water we can take, right? We can have oranges also we can take. So if any liquid or moist object is there that has enough ions to be electrically conductive, can serve as an electrolyte for a cell. We can use a copper wire and we can as a first electrode, and for second electrode we can use as a zinc. So those they will react properly and then they have enough ions to be electrically conductive. Other materials we can use as iron, magnesium, lead, those materials, we can use those as electrodes also. So now, best question, what is the best battery? Everybody now must be aware of batteries, types of batteries, but the question is, what is the best battery, right? We often get puzzled by the announcement of new batteries that are said to offer very high energy densities, they are and able to deliver 1000 charges and discharge cycles and are very thin. Size as well as they are very thin. Are they real? Perhaps yes, but not in one and the same battery. So while one battery type may be designed for small size and long run time, this pack will not last and wear out prematurely. Again, another battery may be built for long life, but the size is big and bulky. A third battery may provide all the desirable attributes, but the price would be too high for commercial use. So we do have some dilemmas in judging what is the best battery. So we will see the merits and the demerits of different secondary batteries. Nickel cadmium, it is quite mature and well understood, but relatively low in energy density. Nickel cadmium is used where long life, high discharge rate and economical price are important. Again, important applications are two-way radios, biomedical equipments are there, like ECG machine analysis is there, EEG machine analysis is there. So all those equipments we can use in nickel cadmium is used. Professional video cameras are there. Then power tools for cutting different cut diamonds also. So those power tools in those machines we have nickel cadmium. Nickel cadmium contains toxic material actually. So it contains a toxic metal which is environmentally unfriendly. So better to avoid this nickel cadmium this metal, because it is toxic and can be poisonous also. Nickel metal hydride, it has a higher energy density compared to nickel cadmium, but at the expense of reduced cycle life. So it won't have a quite long life, right? Nickel metal hydride contains no toxic metals. So it is quite user friendly, environmental friendly. Applications include mobile phones, laptop computers that we daily use, right? Next is the lead acid battery. Most economical for large power applications where weight is of little concern. So this batteries, they are used in like modern car systems. They are used, we can use in hospital equipments. We can use in UPS systems. So lead acid battery is preferred choice for where we want large power applications. Again, wheelchairs, emergency lighting. Lithium-ion, we know about lithium-ion, it is the fastest growing battery system. It is used where high energy density and lightweight is of prime importance. The technology is quite fragile and the protection circuit actually it is needed to assure safety. It do have some side effects, so better we do have a protection circuit inside it. Applications include notebook computers, we all know about notebook computers, and cellular phones. Next is the lithium-ion polymer. It takes some advantages of lithium-ion. And then it offers some attributes of lithium-ion in ultra-slim geometry and simplified packaging. So the packaging is quite simple. Main applications in mobile phones. If you see our mobile phone at the back side, if you take a battery, you can have a lithium ion in that. Okay. So next is we discuss about the merits and demerits of different batteries. Where batteries are used, different applications are there. I will explain each and every application where these batteries are used in detail. First one is the industrial application. Then we have in video cameras, still cameras, then in medical devices, power tools, many more. We have in mobile cameras also, right? Mobile, we have cellular phones, there also this batteries are used. Okay, so we'll see step by step what is the best battery for video cameras. Initially nickel cadmium was applied. Nickel cadmium batteries actually continued to power large percentage of professional cameras. This battery provided reliable service and performs well at low temperature also. Nickel cadmium, it is one of the most enduring batteries in terms of service life, but it is having some problem. It has only moderate energy density and needs a periodic full discharge. So you have to discharge, you have to keep on discharging it, and fully we have to wait for it for this nickel cadmium battery to get discharged. Need for longer run times is causing a switch to that. So that disadvantage, we have to switch to nickel metal hydride. This battery actually offers up to 50% more energy, so it is 50% more efficient than nickel cadmium. However, the high current spikes drawn by the digital cameras have a negative effect, and the nickel metal hydride battery suffers from the short service life. So the life of this battery, it is not that much. So again, there is a trend towards lithium ion, that is the fastest growing battery system. So among rechargeable batteries, this chemistry has the highest energy density and is quite lightweight. It is very light in weight. A steep price tag, but again the disadvantages are like price tag, it is quite steep, and the inability to provide high currents, those are their negatives actually. So what is the best battery for medical devices? One of the best energy hungry portable medical devices is the heart defibrillator. Many of us have seen this instrument is for checking whether your pulse and heart rates are working properly or no, heartbeats are working properly or no. So that is the instrument, heart defibrillator. You might have seen in hospitals, big hospitals. The battery, what this instrument does, it the battery draws in excess of 10 amperes during preparation stages. So during this preparation stages only, it draws excess of 10 amperes. Again, how to check whether that person is alive or no? What the doctor does is several shocks may be needed to get the patient's heart going again. So the battery must not hamper the best possible patient cure. Most defibrillators are powered by nickel cadmium. Nickel metal hydride is also being used, but there is concern of short service life. So the service life, it is quite slow, it is very short. In a recent study, however, it was observed that the defibrillator battery cycles are far less than expected. So instead of anticipated 200 cycles after 2 years of seemingly heavy use, so what the researchers did actually, they did some experiments, and then they anticipated 200 cycles after 2 years of seemingly heavy use. It was seen that less than 60 cycles had been delivered on the battery examined. So smart battery technology makes some such information possible. With fewer cycles needed, the switch to higher energy dense batteries becomes a practical alternative. Again, researchers have done and they have moved to sealed lead acid batteries. They are again often used to power defibrillators intended for standby mode. Although they are bulky and heavy, the lead acid has a low self discharge, and so their life is quite long and can be kept in prolonged ready mode without need to recharge again. Lead acid performs well on high current spurts, but during the rest periods, the battery disposes the depleted acid concentrations back into the electrode. So lead acid would not be suitable for such a sustained high load. So it is good for so the lead acid batteries are good when heavy, when the instrument size or it is bulky and heavy. So in those conditions, lead acid batteries are quite good. Again, when you need a reliable in the sense, when you need to perform a specific task, again when you need a long life, there lead acid batteries are used. Medical industry, it is moving towards lithium ion, robust and economical. That name part is that 186050 cells makes this possible. Short but high current spurts needed for defibrillators are still a challenge. So work is going on in that area. Okay, so what is the best battery for power tools? Power tools, they require up to almost 50 amperes of current and operate in an unfriendly environment. The tool that we use must perform at sub-zero temperatures and endure in high heat. The batteries also must withstand shock and vibrations. So the applications like car batteries, I told you that in cars they undergo various shocks and vibrations. Again, in power tools, they undergo various shocks and vibrations. So the tool we use must perform at sub-zero temperatures and endure in high heat. So batteries that you are going to use should be able to cope with all these environmental possibilities like shocks and vibrations. Most power tools are equipped with nickel cadmium batteries. Again, nickel metal hydride has been tried with limited success. Longevity is a problem, but new designs have improved. Lithium ion, it is too delicate and could not provide the high amperes. Lead acid, it is too bulky and lacks persistent power delivery. The power tool, it is has simply no suitable alternatives but to go back and have the treasured and hardworking nickel cadmium. Okay, so what I will show before this video, what I am going to show is battery, how it looks physically, and how to measure battery voltage. So if you see, this is a battery, right? If you can see, it is a high watt battery, that is a 9 volts battery, right? That is a 9 volts battery. If you see the polarity, you can see the polarity also. At this side, it is written as marked as negative, right? And it is here it is written as positive. So this is the positive side, and this is the negative side. And if you see, it is clearly written as 9 volt battery that is used for transistor radios. So it should give at least 9 volts batteries. Again, it is a, you can't recharge these batteries, so it is disposable or primary batteries. So how to measure the voltage? Actually, it is written actually 9 volt battery. So how to measure this voltage? Okay, if you see, this is actually a multimeter. This is a digital multimeter, and if you can see, there is written DC voltage, so you can measure DC voltage here. Range is up to 1000 DC voltages you can measure. Then if you switch right side, it is written AC voltage, so we can measure AC voltage also, but that will be in RMS. If we click, if we switch